Ending on Craig Venter's X chromosome brings us to another topic, sex linkage. Now, in mammals, males have got an X and a Y chromosome. And the Y chromosome is tiny, and it has very few functioning genes on it, the most important of which is called TDF, the testes determining factor. And this controls the development of the testes and then testosterone. It's the hormones then that do all the work to make men into men. Now, on the X chromosome, men have one X chromosome, but women have two. And there are lots of genes on there. That's a very big chromosome. And just as an example, here at this end of the X chromosome is a protein called DMD. And this has to do with a particular form of muscular dystrophy, which is a degenerative muscular disease. But there's a lot of other genes on here as well. Sex linkage refers to genes that are found on the X chromosome, because the X chromosome codes for a lot of proteins that are important for the physical development of men and women. For example, red-green colorblindness. If you look at this pattern on the right, you might see a 2 or a 5. If you have normal vision, you see a 5, but if you're colorblind, it's a 2. Hemophilia is due to a lack of a blood clotting factor, so even the smallest wound can cause endless bleeding. Here's an example of someone who had an injection with a hypodermic needle, and the blood never clotted around the puncture wound, and so there's hemorrhaging all the way along. Now, the recessive form of these traits, both colorblindness and hemophilia, are on the X chromosome, and they're expressed much more frequently in men than in women. So let's look at sex-linked genes and take, for example, hemophilia, because this is huge for health. So here we're going to have a woman who has two X chromosomes and her husband has a single X chromosome. And the hemophilia is a recessive allele on the sex chromosome, on the X chromosome. And so this woman is going to be heterozygous. So she has one capital H and one hemophilia allele. Her husband is healthy. He doesn't have hemophilia. So he likewise just has the capital H allele. Now in his sperm, half of his sperm possess the X chromosome so that he can produce daughters. And the other half contain the Y chromosome, and those would be his sons. Okay. Now, the woman, half of her gametes are going to have the healthy allele, and so she'll have daughters who don't have the hemophilia allele. They will be homozygous healthy, and their sons will also be healthy. Okay. But the other half of her eggs will possess the hemophilia allele. And so half of her daughters are going to be carriers, will be heterozygote just like she was for the hemophilia trait. And then half of her sons have the hemophilia allele. That's the only X chromosome he possesses. He will have hemophilia. So with these kinds of recessive traits on the X chromosome, women often carry these harmful alleles because it's heterozygote recessive, they're perfectly healthy. But the men, the adult men, rarely survive to have these kinds of traits. So the adult men in the population are going to almost never have these harmful alleles. Okay, so this is the most common way that you'd have a family with this hemophilia allele, coming from the mother, not from the father. And in early infancy, it's the sons, not the daughters, who are going to have the hemophilia trait. These are carriers. They're silent. They don't have hemophilia, only the sons. Now, this can be well appreciated if we look at a very famous family tree. This is Queen Victoria, and a lot of her family and descendants who were in numerous royal courts around Europe in the 19th century. So we have Queen Victoria, a very large family. She had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 children, okay? And the sons are in squares, the daughters are circles. And so she was a carrier for the hemophilia, okay? And out of her sons, she had one hemophiliac son, and she had two daughters who were carriers, okay? Now, being from a royal family, there was some chance that this little boy would manage to survive without ever having bled. And so he grew up, and he had two children, one of which was a daughter who would then be a carrier, because the daughter got the hemophilia allele from his X chromosome. His wife didn't have that trait. And then his son didn't have it because his son got his Y chromosome, but not his X chromosome. Okay? Then if we look at the carriers that are descended from these, they're all women, okay, so they're heterozygote for it. And a proportion of their daughters are going to carry that allele, and a proportion of their sons are going to have hemophilia. And the usual fate of a hemophiliac is to die. So they didn't survive to have offspring. Okay? And we see that in all these different branches carrying this trait. So if we look at this in some detail, we have then just from that one carrier, she had one son who was hemophiliac, two daughters that were carriers, and of those daughters, then she had three grandsons who all had hemophilia. Now, let's look at one particular branch here, Queen Victoria's daughter Alice and her family. So Alice is this heterozygote, she's a carrier, her daughter Irene, okay, had two grandsons here, Valdemar and Henry, who were both hemophiliac. Alice had a son named Fred, who's a hemophiliac. Then she had another daughter named Alex. Alex married Tsar Nicholas of Russia, and they had five children, okay, one of whom, Alexei, a boy, was hemophiliac. There's Alexei. Now, Tsar Nicholas wrote in his diary, it was a dreadful thing to have to live through such anxiety. Any time a child might fall down, skin his knee, cut himself, he could bleed to death right there. So it's an incredibly stressful condition for the family. And it's a fascinating bit of history that Nicholas and Alexander actually hired Rasputin, who was a local faith healer, to keep the young Prince Alexei calm. Rasputin was so effective that the Tsar kept him in the palace despite widespread disapproval from the aristocracy, who didn't know of Alexei's hemophilia. Okay, so Nicholas was a bit ashamed to admit that he had a son with hemophilia. He didn't want anybody to know. He kept Rasputin around to keep him calm. But Rasputin was from a peasant family. He was highly popular with the general population. So when he was assassinated in a bit of jealousy by the aristocracy, that helped to fuel the Russian Revolution. So here's a bit of broad history. The Russian Revolution, which led to the communist takeover and all the rest of that stuff, partly was triggered by a case of hemophilia within that family.